Dear children, welcome back to the second part of the short story Matchbox written by Asha Purna Devi. I hope you remember the opening part of the story, that three-storied mansion and the big joint family. On that Sunday morning, the laundryman has come to collect the soiled clothes. Our protagonist, Nomita, has just found out that crumbled letter from her husband's dresser's pocket. She checked the dates and understood that the letter has come a few days back. She's very much annoyed. Let's see how she responds. Because this incident is not a casual oversight. It is deliberate. Ajit's nature is exactly like that. Somehow, he's gained possession of the key to the letterbox, fishing it through the gaps among the 52 hands of this joint family. And whenever there is a letter with Nomita's name on the envelope, he opens and reads it first. And only then does he give it to her. It is possible that oftentimes he doesn't give it to her at all. At least that is the suspicion that has taken deep root in Nomita's mind. Even though to this day Ajit cannot truthfully make the claim that he's been able to discover any letter in the slightest degree suspicious. Still, this ugly habit of his won't go. Not with Nomita's anger, not with her taking offense, not with bitter reproaches, her trying to shame him, sarcasm, not with anything. If she mentions it, first he tries to laugh it away. And if laughter doesn't get him out of deep water, he scolds her. Ajit is presented as an arrogant husband. He has no respect for Nomita's feelings. He's in the habit of reading his wife Nomita's letters before giving it to her. Sometimes he won't even give that letter to her. He is a suspicious husband. Nomita is very much irritated by this habit. She has several times told him not to do that. But he still continues that ugly habit. But outwardly, he is a large-hearted and high-minded person. She sits perfectly still for a minute and reads the letter through. It's nothing much, a letter from Nomita's mother. It is her standard speech. The good woman has once again placed on the record the news of her various hardships and complaints getting worse. Misfortune upon misfortune. The ceiling of her room is cracked and the rainwater falls through in ceaseless streams. If this is not immediately remedied, she will have to die crushed under the weight of a collapsed roof. Of course, she does not dread that eventually. Her daughter is a queen. Her son-in-law, high-minded, large-hearted, therefore, etc., etc. An indigent widow, without husband or son. She was successful in consigning her daughter to a wealthy family's house on the strength of looks alone. But the good lady has never stopped taking credit at the slightest opportunity for her skill in that matter. And she's been finding such opportunities all along. Whenever Ajit sees a new letter from Nomita's mother, he smiles derisively and says, "Why bother to read that? I'll go and fill out the money order form." Nomita's head hangs low with the shame and the insult of it. So, some time ago, out of anger and grief, Nomita forbade her mother to write to her on postcards. She thought that from then on, she would try to send her a little money, whatever she could pull together in secret. So, this was what came of letters in envelopes too. Suddenly, Nomita flames into anger at her mother. Why doesn't she keep on begging like this? Why won't she let Nomita keep her self-respect, her dignity? No, this time she will write and tell her mother clearly, "I can't do any more. Don't hope for anything from me." Nomita's mother is the second woman presented in the story. Though she does not appear in the scene, her character is portrayed very vividly by the author. She is an indigent widow, a helpless woman, and nobody is there to look after her. She frequently writes letters to Nomita seeking financial help. Her husband, Ajit, always insults Nomita because of her mother's behavior. But the mother thinks that Nomita is living like a queen in her husband's family. Earlier, she used to write letters on postcards. No, it is an open letter and anyone can read it. Nomita felt much humiliated by these letters. She forbade her not to write on postcards. Now she writes in envelopes, that also with the money given by Nomita. Nomita thinks aloud why her mother does not let her keep her dignity and self-respect. Right then, Ajit steps into the room after finishing his leisurely Sunday bath. Nomita's sharp indignation at the insult, simmering all this while, seems to want to dash itself violently against him. Nomita roars out, "When did this letter arrive?" Ajit glances at her obliquely, estimating the magnitude of his error. Another handful of cash for this, he had thought, and decided not to give the letter to Nomita. He was going to tear it up and throw it away. He has made a big mistake. Not that Ajit is going to feel abashed about that. As though trying hard to remember, he says, "Letter? What letter? Oh, yes, yes. Indeed, there was a letter from your mother. I just hadn't got around to giving it to you." "Why hadn't you got around to it? Why? Why? Answer me. Why hadn't you got around to it?" "What a nuisance," Ajit says. "I had forgotten. Why else?" "Liar," Nomita hisses like a snake. "Why are you saying whatever comes to your mouth? Don't people forget?" "No, they don't. Why did you open my letter?" This charge, Ajit tries to scatter to the winds. "What if I opened it? My own wife's letter. Be quiet, be quiet, I tell you. For what reason should you open my letters? Haven't I told you 1,000 times not to? Ajit doesn't fear Namita's anger. He fears a row. So he smiles an affected smile and says, if you are forbidding it, then it is a definite something. Shouldn't I make sure that no one is passing you love letters in secret? Stop it! What a calm and vulgar man you are! Here, Namita questions Ajit about the letter. At first, he tells that he has forgotten to give that letter. But when Namita insists, he tells that it is his duty to ensure that nobody is writing love letters to Namita. Namita could not tolerate her husband's doubting her integrity in a baseless manner. She calls him a vulgar man, an uncultured fellow. After this, it is not possible for Ajit to smile his fake smile any longer. Now, he too picks up the poisoned knife. He says, is that so? Those who whine day and night and hold out their palms to their son-in-law, they are the high-class people. A dung picker's daughter becomes a queen. And so, shut up, Namita yells. Their rooms on the third floor. That's a blessing. Otherwise, with that scream, everyone would have come to look. Shut up, Ajit roars out. What shut up? I'll damn well say it. I'll damn well open your letters. I'll do what I want, what I please. What will you do? Can you do anything? Ajit could not retain his usual calmness when he was called a vulgar man. He too uses his poisoned knife. Here, poisoned knife refers to the insults Ajit uses against Namita. His real face is exposed here. His contempt for Namita's humble background is very well exposed through his insulting words. He calls her a dung picker's daughter. He further provokes her by telling that it is his house and he will do whatever he wants. And he even challenges Namita. I can't do anything. Almost panting, Namita pronounces each word clearly. You want to see if I can do anything? And immediately she does something that is astonishing. She grabs Ajit's matchbox that is lying near his cigarettes on the table and she lights a matchstick and touches it to her sari. Instantly it flares up, the very fine anchal of a wealthy wife's sari. The very next instant, Ajit, have you gone mad? He says and jumps to her side and grabs the burning patch and slaps it between his hands and puts out the fire. And to tell the truth, now he's a little afraid. He looks fearfully at Namita's face, sees a fire burning there, bright, blazing red. He doesn't have the courage to put out that fire by slapping it between his hands. So he tries to pour water on it. With great difficulty, he attempts to speak normally. You lose all common sense when you get angry, don't you? A woman and such anger! Oof! Now we reach at the climax of the story. Namita is very angry and she goes out of control. She threatens Ajit and even tells that she will teach him a lesson. Flaming with anger, she takes the matchbox which was lying on the table and lights a stick and puts it at the end of her sari. It instantly catches fire. Ajit was shocked and rushes towards her side and manages to put out the fire with his hands. And he makes a comment that she loses her common sense when she gets angry. His words, "Women and such anger," echoes the patriarchal concept about women. He believes that his wife should be submissive to his whims and fancies. Who knows what Namita would have said next? But right then, her niece Rini steps into the room. Immediately she says, piercingly, "So Kurima, how much longer does the washerman have to wait? If you don't want to give him any of your clothes, at least tell him." For a second or two, Namita is still, perhaps recalling the washerman's face, waiting for her downstairs. Then she picks up the dirty clothes and starts sorting them. She says in a calm tone, "Go, tell him, I'm coming. I'm bringing the clothes." Namita speaks her mind, so no one attacks her outright to her face. They only pinch her with sharp words. Her second sister-in-law is almost exhausted with work this morning, and seeing her, she puts a twisted smile on her sweat-streaked face and says, "Well, that is something. At least you finally decided to come down from upstairs. Baba, there is no good or bad time for you. You find the smallest excuse to go into your room and get cozy with your husband. Does the love talk never get old?" The whole situation comes back to normal when her niece Rini comes and reminds her that the washerman is waiting outside. She quickly regains her calmness and collects the dirty clothes and goes downstairs to hand it over to the washerman. Then she goes to the kitchen where the other women in the family are cooking food. They tease her and tell that she always spends her time with her husband and their love talk never ends. Namita is happy that nobody heard their quarrels and feels much relieved. Namita looks around once to get a sense of the atmosphere, sees the hurly-burly of the morning, sees the forest of people on either side. Her voice must not tremble. So she too smiles a small smile and says in an extremely soft voice, "Oh, it is nothing like that. You should come and peek in some time. Our talk is all angry talk. Do you know?" Major wife laughs ho ho and says, "Stop it, no wife. Don't cover up the forbidden fish with your pious spinach. We haven't been raised on donkey grass. Why do we need to peek in? What you are showing us right in front of our eyes, 24 hours a day." Namita laughs a laugh that can bring an attractive flush to a white face. After laughing that laugh, she says, "Go on, you say the naughtiest things."
The busy borough wife runs up. "Have you chopped the vegetables yet? Or are you just telling stories?" And suddenly she stops and starts. "What is that? What is this unlucky thing, no wife? How did you burn your anchal that way?" Nomita too starts, but only for a moment. The next instant, she folds the anchal back quickly and says, laughing, "Oh, don't remind me. It is exactly what you keep warning me about. I didn't listen, and see what happened? I used my anchal to lift a hot pot of water off the stove, and that did it." Nomita pulls the basket of potatoes towards herself and sits down to peel potatoes. And in her mind, she keeps thinking about how she might be able secretly to send her mother a few rupees. She can't really write to her. "I can't do any more. Don't hope for anything from me."
We are given some words like kurima, mejo wife, boro wife, etc. These words add a Bengali touch to the story. The author has used a beautiful metaphor to describe a joint family. She uses the word a forest of people. Suddenly, the boro wife notices that Nomita's anchal, the loose end of her sari, is burnt. Nomita calmly tells that it was burnt while she was taking a hot pot of water from the stove. Then she goes to peel the potatoes. While peeling potatoes, she thinks how to send some money to help her mother. Once again, she acts as a meek and obedient wife and submits herself entirely to that unfortunate destiny. Over there, the entire village knows Nomita is a queen. Nomita's husband is high-minded, large-hearted. This is precisely why I compare women to matchboxes. Even when they have the materials within themselves to set off many raging fires, they never flare up and burn away the mask of men's high-mindedness, their large-heartedness. They don't burn away their own colorful shells. They won't burn them. The men know this too. That is why they leave them scattered so carelessly in the kitchen, in the pantry, in the bedroom, here, there, anywhere. Quiet, without fear. They put them in their pockets. As the story ends, Ashapurna Devi sadly tells us that women suppress their agonies and pain in front of others and pretend that nothing has happened. This is the sad reality. The meek and submissive nature of the women is beautifully portrayed. This is exactly the point of comparison between women and matchboxes. Women like Nomita do not cause fire despite being powerful. No doubt, the story has a powerful impact on the society. It makes a strong appeal for a new social order. Ashapurna Devi becomes the voice of the voiceless. The author believes that women have the potential to protect themselves
by speaking out their problems. The unwillingness from the part of a woman makes her more vulnerable and give men a chance to ill-treat her further. It is high time that women should raise their voices against all types of domestic violences. The 21st century witnesses a redefinition of women's role in the family. Education liberates women and labor gives her dignity. She started finding her own space in the public life. This public space won her worthy position in the family also. Women should be treated with care and they should be allowed to enjoy self-respect and dignity in the family circle. Children, don't forget, women empowerment should start from the family. And let the love in our family grow strong and deep, living special moments to treasure and keep.
I'm on the top of the world, looking down on creation. Explanation I can find is the love that I found ever since you've been around. Your love's put me at the top of the world. I'm on the top of the world, down on creation, and the only explanation I can find is the love that I